The command line doesn't have to be a scary place. When used right, it can boost your productivity by at least 10x. Here are 15 commands that will help boost your productivity. Let us know in the comments below what terminal command boosts your productivity. Grep. The grep command lets you search specific patterns in text. So if I were to run this command, grep my pattern file.txt, then it will recursively look for the string proxies equals in the file.txt file. But we could even extend this further by adding a couple of parameters. So by adding dash r, I can now recursively search in many places. And with dash dash include, it limits my search to just PI files. I mean, it really beats the max search, which we all know is super slow. Awk. Now, if you're a millennial like me, then you think this stands for awkward, which, trust me, the syntax can be that sometimes. But rest assured, this has a whole different meaning in the terminal. Awk is a versatile programming language for working on files. If you're looking to handle text files and create formatted reports, this is a tool to use. So the default command would look something like this: awk and then print programming.txt. And it doesn't really do anything apart from print everything line by line. Not really helpful. However, let's put in an expression: awk/types print programming.txt. Now it brings the line that matches the expression you give it. In the scenario where you're trying to quickly parse a spreadsheet file or a table file, you can immediately see the advantages. By default, it just assumes that all your files are separated by spaces. So you can get the second column of each line by doing this: awk print numbers92 file.txt. Looks pretty cool. Okay, but let's get a little bit more advanced. Assuming you want to calculate the sum of a column in a CSV file, you can define the comma delimiter and do this expression to get the sum: awk dash F capital F comma, and then this expression right here. And there you go, the sum. Okay. Let's get a little crazier. If you wanted to count the frequency of a word, you can do this: awk and then, yeah, this gigantic for loop file. Yeah, definitely a little tough. As you can tell, the awk command has a lot of functionality. If you're looking to create a shell script, then this honestly might be the tool to use for you. Sed. Sed, which is short for stream editor, lets you perform basic text transformations on an input stream. Kind of like a find and replace in your favorite code editor. You first put in the expression you're looking to use. In this example here, we want to replace terminal with warp. However, this only changes the first occurrence. We can add a number like this to decide how often, or more realistically, just to do it to the entire file. Cool. Find. The find command is, well, take a wild guess. It's used to search and locate a list of files and directories based on what you give it. So similar to grep, but it actually just finds the file and the directory that is within instead. So if I wanted to find waldo.txt in my current directory, I could do something like this. So find in this current directory, dash name, waldo.txt. I mean, not too productive really, unless it's your desktop, which you gotta get clean in, by the way. So we can recursively search as well. So find in my documents, name waldo.txt. This will then return the path where Waldo was found. We can even customize the ignoring cases, the different file types it searches for, and a whole lot more. It's a great command. Tar. If you want to zip up a whole bunch of files, you can use tar, which takes multiple files and turns it into a tar ball. This basically just means you put it all into one file and zip it. So in this command, I'm going to type tar-cvf awesome.tar and then just all this awesome stuff in this file. CVF stands for create new tar archive, verbosely show the progress, and the file name type of the archive. And just like that, you're finished. Pretty easy. Curl. Now, curl is one of the most popular command line tools. If you're interested, we covered some alternatives in our previous video, so make sure you go check that out if you're interested. Curl lets you transfer data using different network protocols. A simple GET request to a server. We can simulate different methods too if you're testing an API. So if you're testing an API, this is a really good way of doing it. Also, is it curl or is it CURL? My brain hurts. Rsync. Rsync, or remote sync, is a way to copy and sync files and directories from remote computers. So this is the framework of an rsync command: rsync options source destination. So if I wanted to download a directory from a network to my local computer, I can do this. In this example, I'm getting backups from a server to my backups folder. The weird characters stand for archive mode, verbose, compressed file data, and human readable format. Rsync is essential if you're looking to create backups or sync files between different computers. So if you're looking to get into sysadmin or anything, then rsync is arguably one of the most important commands you should know. Diff. The diff command stands for difference. This is similar to anything else you see that is related to seeing difference, like in Git, for example. It works by specifying two files you want to see a difference in. So diff file one and file two. Viewing it like this gives some cool results, but it is very hard to read, to be fair. Now, by adding the dash C flag, or context, as most refer it to, we can get it formatted in a way that's much easier to read. There's a lot of use cases why you might need to see the difference between two files. If it's through version control, or maybe you have to copy a backup and bring it into your new device. There's a lot of things you can do with diff, so I definitely recommend checking it out and using it in your own use cases. Screen. Screen is a terminal multiplexer. Okay, what does that even mean? A device that's like, yeah, I don't get it. Basically, screen lets you have active sessions with many windows in it that will continue to run even if the window isn't visible or if you get disconnected. So if you have scripts that you want to run for very long periods of time or want to run two things in parallel on a server you're SSH'd into, this is the tool for you. So you start by doing this, typing in screen dash capital S and then whatever you want to name that session. So this will create a session called coding with warp. So now you have a cool new terminal session that you can eject out of, especially if you're running a script of some sort. You can then do control A and D and you're out. Go and make a cup of coffee or whatever you do in your spare time, and you can reattach with screen dash R. Now, if you go a little crazy like I do, then you might create a bunch of different sessions. So you can use screen dash LS to see all screens. If you're using a virtual machine and you want to put your infinitely running code there, then this is the perfect tool to use. PS. PS, or process status, is used to list the current running processes on your system. This will also show you the process IDs and other useful information. Now, running PS will just give us some basic columns to view. But if you want to view all processes though, I can run this, PS dash capital A. That's a lot of processes. I can also filter it by running processes. Now, to filter by something I might specifically be looking for, we can add the dash C flag with the process name. PS dash C, Lewis is cool. And just like that, we can find it. Monitoring your processes is huge when you're working with the terminal. And with PS, you have a whole lot of features at your disposal. Features that can help you filter, expand, list different processes that are running on your system. PS is a must use. Dig. There is only one thing that is worse than stubbing your toe, and that is DNS. DNS propagation can take up to 72 hours. Why? Now, a great tool to use to see if DNS has changed is the dig command. Dig gathers DNS information and outputs everything you need to know about its current state. So if I did this, I can see all this information about its current state. This gives you a ton of information to look at, like the current record it has, the query time, and more. If you want to go even deeper, you can add on the plus trace flag, and that will show you the whole entire trip your connection goes through, showing you each server it needs to hit to get to the final destination. And if you want to feel like a hacker and do a reverse DNS lookup, you can use the dash X flag and insert the IP address. Dig is a powerful command that you will use for a couple of use cases, but when those use cases show up, you'll be glad that you used it. Head and tail. So everybody knows about cat, but what happens if you don't want to see the entire file? Head prints out the beginning lines of the file you specify. So if I put head file.txt, I can see the top of file.txt. I can then use the dash n command to specify the amount of lines I want to see. If you really don't want to see much, then you can use dash c to specify how many characters you want to see. If you're into big data, then this command is great for understanding what you're working with, like seeing the columns in the data that you're working with. However, for something like logs, this is kind of useless because you're only seeing the top of the log file, like the oldest logs. This brings us to tail. Now, if you want to see the bottom of the file, you would use tail. Tail has all of the same flags as head, but one thing I think is really cool with tail is the dash dash follow flag, which will continuously loop through the tail command so you are always seeing the bottom of the file. Now you for sure look like a hacker. DF and DU. Okay, let's start talking about commands that are so useful when it comes to working on remote servers and computers. DF and DU are both commands that report disk space usage. DF will display the amount of disk space available on the file system, and DU reports files and directories disk usage. So running DF will bring up your file system with its usage and availability. 512 blocks though, like my brain can't comprehend that. So if I add the dash H flag, which stands for human readable, you get something easy to read. Also, we can use df to get the total amount of space by using the dash dash total flag. We combine this with grep and get something easy to read. Du, on the other hand, is great for finding the size of files and directories. Run the du command on terminal and you get gibberish, similar to what we have with df. But of course, the dash h flag is here to make it easy for us. Should dash h be standard? Whatever. Okay, so seeing all of the output we're seeing is great, but with a directory filled with a large amount of files, I don't want to have to scroll up or parse this output. So by adding an S on the flag, this will summarize it. Another fun little tidbit is the time flag. This will show when the file was last modified, which is also pretty useful. Top and htop. If you're running a server, this is especially key to your workflow. Top is a really mature command that has been around since 1984. The top command displays information about the system's running processes and resource usage. So when you run the command, it's information overload. Like, what am I looking at here? Well, it's divided into two areas, the summary and the process list. Now, for the most part, the information on the summary is pretty straightforward. The process is similar to what you would see if you're on the activity monitor on your Mac or resource monitor on Windows. Now, if you're looking to kill a process, you would usually find the process ID here to be able to know which command to run. A great alternative if you have it or you're able to download it off the internet is htop, which works very similarly, but it's a lot more modernized and easier to use. Chown and chmod. Chown lets you change ownerships of files and directories in a file system. Okay, I think it's chown because, you know, we're talking about ownership here, but chown just sounds a lot cooler. If you're running a server, you're most likely managing different users, or at least I hope you are. Some of those users being remote users for people to access, or programmatic users like your web server having certain access to things. So if you want to give ownership to yourself, then you should do this, me being the name of the user. Of course, this doesn't work on directories and its files, so you can use the simple dash r flag to recursively assign files. And if you want to view that ownership, you can use the ls command. Chmod, on the other hand, changes permissions of files and directories. Chmod stands for change mode, but I'm gonna continue to say chmod, okay? Take these numbers into consideration, 7, 5, and 4, which stands for user, groups, and others. So the number combination works like this. 4 is read, 2 is write, 1 is execute, and 0 is no permission. So 7 in this case is 4, 2, and 1. Read, write, and execute. 5 is read, no write, and execute. 4 being read, no write, and no execute. Now, it's very important to determine what file permissions you need to give to your user groups. For example, you don't want to do 777 for important files, especially if you're running a web server. Similar to last time, you can run the same command as above to see its current permissions. So rather than going on Stack Overflow or ChatGPT and asking what the file permission should be, actually think about what the file permissions should be on your server to be the most secure. So hopefully these commands I showed you help you become a more productive developer. Make sure to subscribe for more terminal related content and let us know in the comments what terminal commands you use on a day-to-day basis.